Welcome to the course on game theory in the autumn term 2020 at the University of Mannheim. This is the first video of week 9. Now we come to the section on extensive games without perfect information. So a game without perfect information, there one does not know everything. One may think of some card games where nature gives every player some cards and one doesn't know which cards the other players get. But this is what it is. The game is like this. But what one could ask for at least is to have a good memory. So and this condition is called perfect recall. And in the first part of this section is about perfect recall. And later, the later part of the section is about three different kinds of strategies in such games and their logical interrelations. So definition on perfect recall. So we start with an extensive game with or without chance moves and without perfect information. So it's the 7-tuple which we know already. So here A is a set of person players, Z is a set of possible moves, B is the game tree, P is the player map, which maps every non-final play to the player who has to make the next move. U with index E is the utility function. It associates to any final play a vector of real numbers, so one number for each person player. W alpha for any play alpha, where the player nature has to make the next turn, is a probability distribution over the possible moves of player nature at this play alpha. And I1 to IM is gives the non-perfect information. I upper index I is a partition of the set of non-final plays at which it is the turn of player I to make the next move. So a partition means that one decomposes the set BI into a disjoint union of subsets. So and II is a tuple of these subsets. And these subsets are called information sets. So I will give examples soon. So the information set of a player alpha is also called I upper index player of alpha. So it is one of these subs of these elements of the tuple II. So the interpretation is as follows. At the play alpha, the player I, player P of alpha, does not know that he is in the play alpha. He knows only that he is one play in the set II of alpha. So he knows that he is an alpha, of course, if this set consists only of one element, but that's a special case of perfect information. So without perfect information means that at least one of these information subsets consists of more than one element. So I will give you examples soon. Now I want to introduce some more notations in order to define the property perfect recall. So for any person player I, so not the player nature, and any play where it's a turn of player alpha to do the next move, we consider the finite set of all those plays which come before alpha, and where it's also the next move has to be done by player alpha, by the player I. So here I have made a sketch of this. You can see it here. So downstairs you see the play alpha. It is here. Maybe I write this in yellow. So here's the play alpha. And then in my example here, we have two other plays, here and here, where it's where player alpha has to make the next move. So, and yeah, then these plays which come before alpha, then are called beta 1 of alpha and beta 2 of alpha until beta A of alpha for some index A of alpha. And they are ordered by appearance in this sequence of moves. So, and yeah, the player usually does not know these plays because he doesn't know that he is in the player alpha. But in Perfect Recall demands that he knows at least the corresponding information sets. So, maybe here. So each of these elements, beta 1 of alpha, is contained in some information set. And beta 2 of alpha is also contained in some information set. And so here, this is one information set, and this is also some information set here. So, and yeah, Perfect Recall demands that the player I knows the corresponding information sets of the plays which he had, through which he had gone before, and at which it was his turn to do the next move. So, and even more, one also wants him to remember what have been the next moves in these plays. So maybe let me again use some color here. No. Yeah, it's here. So here's the next move. And here's also one next move. So here these are the next moves. So one also wants the player to remember the moves which he had done in the place before the play alpha, where it was his turn to make the next move. So that in this sequence of moves here. So in the case of Perfect Recall, one demands that the player I should remember the information sets of the place before alpha, where it was his turn to make the next move, and he should also remember the corresponding next move which he had done before. So he should remember his part of the history of the game as soon as good as he can. He can't remember the place, but he can remember the corresponding information sets. So here it's written again. So the game has Perfect Recall. If for any two plays alpha and alpha tilde in the same information set of the partition, the sequences in 5-5 and in 5-6 coincide. The sequence in 5-5 was the sequence of the information sets of the plays before alpha. And the sequence in 5-6 is the sequence of the next moves which the player had carried out after these plays before. So that he should remember. So Perfect Recall means the player should have a memory as good as possible. He should at least remember these information sets and the next moves which he had carried out. So, yeah, here it's again written. Perfect Recall means that the player remembers at each play the information sets of all earlier plays at which it was his turn to move, and also he remembers his moves at these plays. So it's a very natural condition. So in a game with perfect information, at a play alpha, the player knows the play alpha, and he knows all the moves before, and he knows also the plays before. Therefore, he knows everything, all this data in 5-4, 5-5, and 5-6, thus, a game with perfect information does trivially have perfect recall. Now I give you two examples which do not have perfect recall for different reasons, and then the third example which does have perfect recall. So in the first example here, already the earlier plays are not well remembered. So here is a picture. So this is really a nasty game. So player 1 starts the game at the play alpha 1, and he can make the move E or F. Then it's the turn of player 2 to make the next move, the move C or D in both cases, in both plays. And then again it's the turn, and then in 3 or 4 cases it's again the turn of player A to make one of the moves E or F. In the fourth case one has already reached the final play. So and here you see the player 2 has only one information set, that's easy. But player 1 has here 4 non-final plays where it's had turn to make the next move, and they split into 3 information sets. And especially the first information set is very nasty here. You see that alpha 1 and alpha 4 are in the same information set. That means when the player has reached alpha 4, he does not remember whether he is at the start of the game or whether he is at this play alpha 4. So he's really not remembering well what happened. He doesn't even know whether he's just at the beginning of the game or already at almost at the end. So yeah, and the sequences, in the case of Alpha 1, the sequences in 5-4 and 5-5 are both empty. There are no earlier plays. In the case of Alpha 4, the sequence in 5-4 is just the one earlier play of player 1, namely Alpha 1. And then the corresponding information set is just the information set I-1-1. So the sequences in 5-5, they do not coincide. The one for Alpha 1 is empty. The one for Alpha 4 is not empty. It is, it contains I-1-1. So we do not have perfect recall in this game. Alpha 1 and Alpha 4 are the same information set, but the sequences in 5-5 do not coincide. So this is a very bad case. He remembers essentially nothing. He shouldn't play. So the next game also does not have perfect recall, and the reason is not as cruel as before, but it's also serious. So here you see the game. I've written something additional downstairs. Here again, player one starts and has to make one of the two moves A or B, and then it's the turn of player two. Player two has only one information set, so he does not know which move player one had done, whether it's A or B. But in any case, he has the choice between C or D. And in Alpha 2, the result will be Alpha 4 and Alpha 5. In Alpha 3, the result will be Alpha 6 and the final play. So, then afterwards, in three of the four resulting plays, it's again the turn of player 1 to do the next move, which is E or F in any case. In the fourth play, it's already final. There's nothing more to do. So here, plays Alpha 4, Alpha 5, Alpha 6 are in one information set, so that player 1 knows that he's not at the beginning, but he does not know what player 2 has done, and more seriously, he does not know what he himself has done. So he knows that he's not again at the beginning of the game, he knows that he has done one of the two moves A or B, but he doesn't know which one. In the case of Alpha 4 and Alpha 5, he has done the move A before. In the case of Alpha 6, he has done the move B before. And he doesn't remember. He cannot distinguish these moves. He doesn't remember what he had done before. Therefore, this also does not have perfect recall. So, and formally, here, for these three plays in the information set II, Alpha 4, Alpha 5, Alpha 6, the first sequence is the same. It has always just one element, namely the play at the beginning, Alpha 1. So it's given here. So the sequence 5-4 is the same. Then also the sequences 5-5 is the same for all three plays, Alpha 4, Alpha 5, Alpha 6. It's always I-1-1, which is a set which contains only Alpha 1. But the sequence of the next moves is different. In the case of Alpha 4 and Alpha 5, the next move has been A, the next move after the first move, after the first play. And then in the case of Alpha 6, the next move after the first play has been B. Therefore, this sequence 5-6 does not coincide for these three plays in the information set I-1-2. And therefore, we do not have perfect recall. But more down to earth, it's just that in the information set I-1-2, the player 1 does not remember. He does remember that he had carried out the move in the play Alpha 1, but he does not remember which move, and therefore he does not have perfect recall. So this now has illustrated the meaning of this perfect recall in two different ways. And here comes now a positive example. This example does have perfect recall. It is almost the same as the example before, but now I have remedied this situation here. I have split I-1-2 into two information sets. One contains Alpha 4 and Alpha 5, and the other contains Alpha 6. So that now, if the player can distinguish between Alpha 6 on one side and Alpha 4, Alpha 5 on the other side, he remembers the move which A or B which he had done before. So here he remembers in the case of Alpha 6 that he had done the move B before. In the cases of Alpha 4 and Alpha 5, he remembers that he had done the move A before. So this game has perfect recall. And now I finish this video now by the next lemma, which gives again some theoretical result. So let's again look at the extensive game with or without chance moves and without perfect information. Then part A somehow fits to the most cruel example in part 3 above. Suppose we have two non-finite plays in this, which is the same player I has to do the next move, and the one comes before the other, so alpha comes before beta. Then if we have perfect recall, then the corresponding information sets cannot be equal. So this strengthens the observation which we had done here in part 3. Here we had seen that alpha 1 and alpha 4 were in the same information set, although alpha 1 comes before alpha 4 and therefore it's not perfect recall. Now I can also say the opposite. I can now follow, this is now an implication of the part A of this lemma. If we have perfect recall, this cannot happen. We cannot have in two different plays, one coming before the other, where this is the same, where the same player has to do the next turn and where the information set coincide. So somehow this example is generalized to part A of this lemma. And maybe and part B says the following. It's an if and only if condition. The game has perfect recall if and only if, for any player and any two plays where it's the turn of the player to do the next move, and any two plays such that beta comes before alpha, and for any move Z such that beta Z comes before alpha, the following holds. For any other play alpha tilde in the same information set as alpha, there must be a corresponding play beta tilde, and such that beta tilde and the move Z come before alpha tilde. So the beta must have a partner which comes before beta tilde, which comes before alpha tilde, together with the next move Z. And if this holds, then we have perfect recall, and if you have perfect recall, then this holds. So now I will go into the proofs. Part A is quite easy, part B is a bit more difficult. So first I go into part A. So I make an indirect proof. So suppose we have now two plays where it's the turn of the player I to do the next move, such that play alpha comes before play beta. And suppose they have the same information set. Maybe here we are. So suppose I call them alpha 1 and alpha 2. So suppose we have two plays, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Alpha 1 comes before alpha 2. And in both cases, player I has to do the next move. And suppose now that II of alpha 1 is equal to II of alpha 2, so they are in the same information set. And suppose that perfect recall holds. We want to show that this is impossible. Then the sequence 5-5 for alpha 1 contains this information set, the information set of alpha 2, II of alpha 2. But by perfect recall, then the sequence 5-5 for alpha 2 contains the same information set. Because in this case, because of perfect recall, alpha 1 and alpha 2 cannot be distinguished by the player. So we must have the same sequence. And then also the same information set coming before. So because the sequence for alpha 2 contains this information set, II of alpha 1 and equal alpha II of alpha 2, then there must be another play before alpha 2 with the same information set. So there must be another play alpha 3 which comes before alpha 2 which also has this information set. Yeah, because alpha 1 had some other play with this information set coming before, and then alpha 2 has it, and this must come from some play alpha 3. So in repeating this, we can construct an arbitrary long sequence of plays which come earlier and earlier and earlier, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, until alpha n, which have all the same information sets. So before alpha 1, we have then an unbounded tower of plays with all the same information set. And there's such an unbounded tower of plays which come before the play alpha 1 that's impossible in our game tree. So this is absurd, this gives you a contradiction. So this is a proof of part A. Now for the proof of part B, here, I want to prove an if and only if characterization of this perfect recall. Perfect recall was formulated in terms of coincidence of two sequences, sequence 5.5 and sequence 5.6, for all plays in the same information set. And here the part B now rewrites this without the sequences, with some, apparently maybe weaker condition. And I will argue that it is equivalent. So, again, suppose we have two plays, alpha and alpha tilde, which are in the same information set. And suppose perfect recall holds. Then the sequences 5.5 of alpha and alpha tilde coincide. So, and before alpha, there comes some beta. There's also the turn of player I to make the next move. And therefore, the same the information set of beta appears also in the sequence 5.5 for alpha tilde. And therefore, there's a beta tilde, which gives rise to this information sequence in the sequence to this information set in the sequence of alpha tilde. So it has the same index because the sequence is 5.5 for alpha and alpha tilde coincide. So, and then also the sequence in 5.6 for alpha, alpha and alpha tilde coincide. That means that also the move after this play with index j must be the same. So the j of alpha must be equal to the j of alpha tilde. And I called this here already z. So then that means that also the next moves must coincide. And that means that beta tilde z comes before alpha tilde. So this was the easier part. Somehow the characterization with the sequences is a more explicit characterization. And from this follows that we have this beta tilde and also the next move z. And for the other direction, maybe stay a little bit vague. I will not carry out every detail. So for going backwards, now we have this condition that for any alpha and alpha tilde and beta before alpha with beta z before alpha, we have beta tilde before alpha tilde and now we have the information sets. And we have beta tilde before alpha tilde and also z beta tilde z before alpha tilde. Then I want to show that we have perfect recall. So this condition, which is Heisenberg number 5.7, shows that the sets of elements in the sequences in 5.5 for alpha and alpha tilde coincide. So if we beta runs through this set of elements of the sequence 5.5 for alpha, and beta tilde runs through the set of elements of the sequence 5.5 for alpha tilde. So they must be the same. And we also know that always the next move towards alpha must be the same, like this condition 5.7. So, and it rests to see that not only the sets of elements of the sequence coincide, but also the sequences themselves. And here I do not go to all the details of this argument. One has to use repeatedly this property, the quality of the sets for the different elements of the set. So, if we start with some alpha and alpha tilde and look at the sequence of alpha, and maybe look at the first or second element of the sequence, then maybe I will try to write something. So we have somewhere here, we have alpha, and then we have the sequence. So we have now three other elements. Yeah, and now I have here maybe some beta 2 of alpha. Then before beta 2 comes only beta 1 of alpha. So if you now concentrate first on beta 2 of alpha, then we know that before beta 2 of alpha there comes only one element, and therefore the set here determines the sequence. So the sequence for beta 2 of alpha is fixed. And then we can go downstairs and in the next level, there's an induction proof. We can find, I don't want to go to details. We can finally arrive to show that also the whole sequence of move of plays before alpha is fixed. The whole sequence of plays where it's the turn of player I to do the next move is fixed. So, yeah, admittedly, this final part is written rather sketchily, and also my explanation is now a bit sketchily, but it does work and it's not so interesting. So here I finish this video. Thank you very much for your attention.